This is Mr. French with American River College, the small engine class, AT301, Hort 330. I have two lawnmowers here that we're going to do some diagnostics on today. This green one here was a side of the road find. It doesn't even run. We're going to do some no start diagnostics on that in a separate video. This red snapper right here has a Briggs & Stratton 3.5 horsepower motor on it, and it has a smoking complaint. So we're going to start by going over the startup procedures, and then we'll show you the engine smoking, and we'll do some diagnostics to figure out why it's burning so much oil. Okay, before you go to start this engine up, you first want to check and make sure it has gas in it. This is a four-stroke engine, which means it would take regular gasoline, not a pre-mix like a two-stroke engine would. For these engines, just normal 87 octane gas is just fine. Next, we're going to check the oil. This particular engine has a dipstick built into the oil fill cap. So we're going to take that out, we're going to wipe it off, and check that oil level. The customer's complaint is that the engine is smoking. That could simply be because it's overfilled full of oil. So we've lightly seated the stick. We're going to pull it out and check the oil level. Oftentimes you have to flip it up over to the other side to really read that level, because it'll wipe on the side of the dipstick tube and give you an incorrect reading. This guy is slightly over full for where he's supposed to be, which could be partially leading to the smoking complaint. We're going to do some other tests to figure out as to why. Now, I always like to put the oil on a clean white paper towel so you can really tell the oil's condition. This oil is pretty dark, and not only is it dark, but you can see that dark discoloration in the paper towel, not from just the oil darkening, but from contamination in the oil. It's really important to remember that most small engines, like this one right here, does not have an oil filter, so changing the oil on a periodic basis to keep it clean is really important. The last thing I'll finish up with is I'll take a quick smell of the towel. If it smells like fuel, even if the oil looks clean on the towel, if it smells like gasoline, it's time to change that oil. Now, how could the oil get over full and smell like gas? Well, like I said, on the over full part, it could be just the owner putting too much oil in the engine. But if it also smells like fuel, when these engines sit, sometimes the fuel can go into the crankcase through a sticky carburetor float, or just from a carburetor that's dramatically overfueling the engine. Both things could end up with a diluted crankcase, meaning a crankcase where the oil is full of gasoline. All right, we're gonna go ahead and fire this thing up. I wanna go over a few controls. This thing used to have a self-propelled feature. It looks like that has been disabled or removed from it. On the throttle, we're gonna move it all the way here to choke because the engine is cold. The other thing we're gonna do is have our emergency brake pulled in. Now, if you have an engine that won't spin when you pull it over, it could be that the brake system is on, in that due to safety regulations that came about in the 1980s, they required lawnmowers to have a brake that not only would cut power to the ignition to stop the motor, but would also engage like a brake shoe around the flywheel that will stop the engine from spinning. So if something happened to the operator, if they were getting injured, they could let go of this and it would stop the engine very quickly. There is an adjustment on this. On engines that sit around, oftentimes they'll become seized because the brake gets stuck on. So I just wanted to point that out. This control right here is again for the self-propelled feature. That feature is not being used on this engine anymore. So we're just going to hold the brake on. We're going to put our foot on the engine, put our safety glasses on whenever we're operating outdoor power equipment, and we're going to fire it up. okay, so we've laid out some diagnostic tools to figure out why this engine is smoking. What we noticed from the previous clip where we're using the lawnmower, it smoked a lot on startup. As the engine ran, the smoke progressively got less and less. There could be a few reasons for that. It could be that when the engine parts are cold, they've shrunken down, they're not fitting as well together, and so you have more leakage past the piston rings. As it heats up, everything fits together a little bit better and the oil consumption goes down. Or it could be related to maybe how the engine was stored. If the engine was stored at an angle, that could put a lot of oil up into the combustion chamber and it could have been burning that out. The tests we're gonna do with these tools, though, will help us make a definitive determination as to what was going on. So if we look down at the tools on the table here, let me show you what we have. Okay, so the tools we have here on the table are tools that are gonna help us diagnose what's wrong with this engine. I have our Briggs & Stratton manual up here for L-head or flathead engines, and two different diagnostic tools. The first one is a compression tester. Okay, this is the same type of compression gauge you use on an automotive engine. You can buy these for somewhere between $20 to maybe $50 from your local auto parts store or tool supplier. However, you can also check these out from O'Reilly's and AutoZone as part of their customer tool checkout programs. And this is the tool we're going to use in this video. However, I do want to show you this tool right here. This is a cylinder leak down tester. Now this tool will be more accurate. It gives you more information in that it can tell you how much leakage has passed an exhaust valve or an intake valve or the piston rings for that matter. And it's actually a tool they recommend that you use in the Briggs & Stratton manual. The downside of this tool is the way it works is you take compressed shop air going into the tool. The tool then feeds that, air out of it into the engine. So if you don't have compressed shop air at your home garage or your shop, this tool's not gonna work for you. That's why we're gonna focus on the other one today. Later on, I'll do some videos using a leak down tester so you can see how that particular item works. Lastly on the table, of course, we have our safety glasses. We have a 3/8 ratchet with a 3-inch extension on there, a series of spark plug sockets. I also have just a regular adjustable wrench. A lot of folks call this a crescent wrench after the Crescent Tool Company made that wrench design real popular. With the spark plug sockets, I do want to point out that what makes them different than a regular deep socket, if you can zoom in on this, what makes this different than a regular deep socket is that it's got a little rubber isolator on the inside that will help keep you from breaking the spark plug. So it's just safer to use an actual spark plug socket when removing a spark plug rather than using a standard deep socket. There's three sizes of spark plug sockets here. The two most popular are 5/8 and 13/16. Some engines will use a 3/4 inch spark plug, and there are some new micro spark plugs out there that use even smaller sockets. The last tool that we need to talk about is this jumper wire. It's just a basic little jumper wire. I'll show you what we're gonna do with that here in a minute. We're gonna disconnect the spark plug wire from the top of the spark plug. We've already ran this engine and cut some grass, so it's warmed up and up to temperature. This engine uses the bigger spark plug design, so the 13/16 is what fits it. I broke that guy loose. Spin him out. When you have the spark plug removed, it's a great time to kind of inspect how the engine was running. Can you zoom in on the spark plug? I don't want to touch the spark plug with my hands because it's still very hot. But if I look inside here, I can see that there is quite a bit of carbon buildup on the outside, which indicates that it was burning oil. And it also is a pretty dark brown color. So by looking at that, you can see that the engine not only was burning oil, probably was running a little bit on the rich side as well. With the spark plug removed, we're now going to ground the coil wire. Now, I could just not use a jumper wire and stick this guy in there. However, it's going to be a little bit more secure if I use my jumper wire. Now, why am I doing that? Well, on this engine, I could have just left that hanging, but a lot of more modern engines, they have a pretty sophisticated ignition system. That's the system that fires the spark plug or delivers electricity to the spark plug to jump inside the engine. And we could possibly damage some of the electronics that control the ignition system if we do not provide it a path to ground. So just keeping good work practices, I wanted to ground that jumper, that spark plug wire with this jumper wire so you could see how that was set up. Next up, we're going to install our compression tester. Okay, with our compression tester, we have a couple different adapters. These adapters would allow us to fit into different thread pitch ranges of spark plugs. It even comes with a quick test adapter where you put this adapter on there with this rubber cone and pull it over while you held the compression gauge on there. What I don't like about that is it's next to impossible to pull starter while you hold this in place without having it fall off and losing the reading. So we're going to use the threaded adapter. And if I can get that in the screen, what you'll notice is there's a little Schrader valve in the end of this. It almost looks like a tire Schrader valve, but it's different. The spring tension in it is different. If your compression gauge does not appear to be working, the first thing I would do is replace that Schrader valve. So we've screwed in our adapter hose. You just lightly seat it. Don't go crazy tight on this. There's no need for that. I've seen students get these stuck inside their engine. And then we're going to set up our compression gauge so we can read it. What I'm going to do is go up to the controls and pull this engine through several compression strokes. In fact, what I want is I want to get through 5 compression strokes on the gauge, and we'll get that on the recording. All right, so we're going to keep it zoomed in on the compression gauge face, but remember, I'm holding the emergency stop down so that the engine can spin. If I don't hold that stop down, it'll be next to impossible for me to turn over the engine. So the brake's held down, the engine won't start because the spark has been grounded out and the spark plug is removed. And we're going to pull this thing through 5 compression strokes and take a reading. And there we have it. You can see we're up around 70 PSI on the compression gauge. And quite honestly, that's where most of these normally are. You're not going to get 100, 120 PSI out of one of these small engines because they have a mechanism on the camshaft that automatically releases the compression to enable you to pull start it. So because of that, a minimum of about 50, a high of maybe 75 PSI, that's the normal amount of compression you would expect. If you have less, if you have 20, 30, 40, you definitely have a compression problem that needs to be diagnosed by further engine disassembly and investigation. Okay, so we got our compression reading of 70 PSI with our dry compression test. We're going to follow that up with what is called the wet compression test. I'll release the pressure, disconnect my gauge, remove my adapter. And what I have here is just a little oil squirt bottle. This has the same type of engine oil, that 1030 weight oil that you'd normally run on one of these engines. And we're going to put about a teaspoon's worth of oil inside this engine. Now, I've already counted that out, and that's about 5 squirts or pumps with this particular oil can. That oil is going to go in there and coat the cylinder walls and help the piston rings seal to the cylinder walls. If we have a large increase in compression now when we do the test again, that will tell us we have worn piston rings. So I'm hooking up my compression gauge and we're gonna pull it through another 5 strokes. So now you can see we're well over 90 PSI. It looks like we're nearing 100 PSI, which is a pretty big rise in compression, right? We've gone up by 30 PSI on the wet test. So even though our compression was relatively adequate when we did the dry test, we had a big rise on the wet test, which does indicate some worn rings. But what we're going to do to eliminate the basics is we're going to go ahead and do an oil change on this engine. We do know that it runs, it does have compression, it does smoke more than we like, but we're going to change that oil, refill it with the proper oil and the proper amount, and see if that reduces the engine's oil consumption. And that might be an acceptable fix for this engine for the customer that doesn't spend a lot of money.